think is working out. See, I think part of what I wanted to say was covered by Pratyush. See, implementing time is the biggest risk. So what I feel and what I have faced, the biggest challenge is right now constraint of trained manpower. See, what has happened is that when any sector is growing, a lot of emphasis on business development because you are trying to grow as fast as possible. Fortunately, business development guys are slightly more fungible across the sectors. But when it comes to implementation, then the fungibility decreases a lot. Because you need to, I can have somebody from thermal or hydro doing a BD or putting up a bid for solar, but I cannot have a guy who has experience in thermal putting up a solar plant. So we have to see, we were able to manage bidding 2000 megawatts to bidding 20,000 megawatts in a year. Let's see how we manage developing 2000, 3000 megawatts a year to developing 20,000 megawatts a year. This in my view would be the next big challenge. There's another thing which is slightly off the topic, and usually I avoid speaking things which has not been asked for, but I was not able to control myself. I don't know, when you're talking about a new plan and we are saying 260 megawatts of thermal, which is the peak capacity which India would require in 2022. At the same time, we are talking about developing 160,000 megawatt of renewables. So we'll stop thermal in morning and start in evening. I don't know how will it work. As far as I understand, thermal plants are designed for 500 stops in the lifetime. If we do 365 in a year.
Absolutely. I think one of some of the clear kind of signals of a kind of a national energy kind of policy is very important. I think so if you ask me personally, the CEA does a great disservice to the nation by publishing about framework saying that we are power supply. I think that's the biggest disservice to the nation that they can do by not accounting correctly for the road trading, etc. I think even today, apart from Delhi and Bombay, you go to any other town, you will have load shedding. unless and until you have a single diesel genset running, which is supplying power today at 16 rupees, you cannot say that the utility sector is power surplus. And the CA reporting, I have to spend so much of time convincing our international investors and developers that, listen, India is not power surplus. You can come and make your plan.
You don't provide access to power to people, don't create demand, and then you definitely will be power surplus.
Thank you. Actually, you have taken 3 points and you have allowed 3 more points from the other participants. So we are not left with many. But actually, for me, if you look at Indian market in global context, it is one of the very few protected markets. Okay. Like, for example, in Europe, we have anti-dumping duty. In US, we have anti-dumping duty. In Japan, there are strict technical parameters for the equipment imported. But for India, we don't have anything, neither in form of a tax nor in form of a technical requirement. So that is the reason our whole solar story is over dependent on Chinese manufacturing ecosystem. Now, so it would also depend on the kind of geopolitical relationship that we have with China. Because yesterday I was reading on the newspaper, there was some noise about Chinese participation in transmission companies. Now, if that be the case, and if just extends beyond that to something like modules, then I think the whole economics and the whole storyboard of solar will going to change.
Oh, absolutely, Ashish. In fact, that's a classical kind of economic and policy question, right? We had two successful industries and both followed very, very different models, and solar actually had to choose which one. You had the Indian automobile industry. For the longest time, we had very strict import duties, 100%, 200% kind of duties, which allowed the Indian industry to flourish. But the cost was paid by the customer that, at least till the 1990s, Indian cars, we didn't have much options. We continue to pay the highest kind of prices for power. And the other kind of extreme is the telecom sector, where on the equipment side, the government completely opened it up, which essentially means that we don't have a telecom hardware manufacturing industry in the country. We only import, but then we do enjoy the lowest telecom tariffs. I think that's the kind of policy dilemma even the solar policymakers had at the beginning. You can kind of try to develop the Indian domestic industry, but then we would possibly be still paying 8 rupees for solar, right? But we have right now left it. So I think it's a point. It has its pros and cons.
My only worry is if we follow the policy over a longer term, that's fine. Only the challenge comes when there is a flip-flop in the policy.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think with WTO in the play, I think I think the return to the automobile industry model doesn't seem to be, isn't likely. And I don't think that's a preferred approach also. So I think yes, quality controls can be there, but I think the manufacturing industry has to find competitiveness on its own rather than on protective kind of barriers in today's globalized kind of world. Vikas, have all the risks been covered or?
You have covered most of the points, but there are a few points which I was thinking that somebody will take it up and I will have no opportunity to tell them, but yes, they are still left out. Good for me. The one important thing we need to understand is Indian solar market or renewable market is not controlled by Indians anymore. It is a globally controlled and globally driven market now, whether it is manufacturing or whether it's development or whatever. So therefore, most of the things, equipments as well as money is coming from abroad, and dollar plays a very, very critical role for these development activities. 4 months back when Trump came in, we all thought that the dollar will go up, it will appreciate. It is actually coming down. So now in Badla bid, people must have thought that dollar will be at maybe 63, 64, whatever. Somebody must have made that assumption. But again, that is not in our control. The guy is moving around the world and he is also trying to put in his all efforts to shift the industry to America back. And that may again drive the dollar to go up. So whatever benefits that you have reaped out of this falling dollar, that will go off in a day. And dollar, it fluctuates very, very heavily in India. Within a month, 4 months, it goes from 64 to 68, then comes to 65 like that. So this is one thing which is going to be a key driver, which is unknown to us. The second important point is, technically, there is a problem with renewable energy. The solar doesn't work whole 24 hours, right? Why would the DISCOM, which is already, after such a problematic, such a traumatic time, they have come up with at least 12, 13 hours of power supply or 16 hours of power supply to people, again try to venture into something which disturbs their balance. And therefore, we will have to go towards a hybrid solution. Solar alone, trying to do 100 gigawatt of solar on its own may not be acceptable to the DISCOMs. Presently, we are only at 13.5 gigawatt when our transmission lines are already facing that difficulty. So therefore, we are hearing that there are hybrid solar parks also coming up, and maybe some ILFS guys are also trying to do that. We will have to find out the technical solution to inject this solar power and wind power into the grid without disturbing our distribution system.
No, point well made, Vikas. Just a small point, I think so this not being in control of your own destiny, now that's the nature of the globalized world. Today, India imports 80% of its energy demand via crude imports. We neither control the price of crude, neither we control the dollar rate which it's denominated in. So I think that's fine. Whatever it is, it's still a stock trade, it's not an O&M trade, right? So whatever projects have been built, even if tomorrow Chinese were to raise their module prices arbitrarily, it's not going to deny us the benefit of the plants which have already come up. So in that sense, it's,
Yeah, but the
sense,
plants that are under development, correct. You have around 10 gigawatts of plant which are going to develop, and if the dollar fluctuates, then it's definitely
You have the same UMPP kind of a situation, but that risk is, I think, a part of what developers are making the return for, right? I think that's
maybe you guys will reduce your interest rates. Yeah? I'm expecting. The way you are happily announcing this thing, I can I can accept it.
Pradeep, any specific point that you would like to make?
So I would like to tell you the other story. I am into solar power development for quite some time now, almost 8 years. But I happen to be a distribution guy. I was working with Tata Power for a long time, since 2003, in distribution. So now when we talk about distribution companies are not geared up, they are not open to acceptance of the fact that their customers are going away, they have their side of problems. Their side of problems are related to maybe disturbance in the grid. Yes, solar creates disturbance in the grid. We have to accept that. Why? Because you are supposed, say, putting up 500 kilowatt on some rooftop, some private customer rooftop. Now you are generating at a curve like this, and sometime your plant just shut down. And you are not connected to your state load dispatch center. As a private customer, you are not supposed to, if you are not a megawatt sort of customer. So how do this distribution company provide you power in that duration? He's not having any prediction from your side. So we have to think as an industry, how do we enable those distribution companies? How do we upgrade their skills, their infrastructure side and their technology? We have to understand and match the requirements. As a industry, we should definitely look into not only putting solar on rooftops or any greenfield projects. We have also to see whether this entire generation to distribution system is integrated and monitored and balanced, of course. Other point I want to talk, Pratyush talk about something like manpower shortage or manpower crunch in the market. Being a project guy, I have been traveling to country, various parts, mostly into remotes, because you have solar projects into remote areas. So the problem is we generally hire people from tier 1, tier 2 institutes, and we think that they will go and set up the project for us. It's difficult. There is two part of country. When you go to 200 kilometer from any tier 2 city to find a land, and that's no man's land. You want to buy the cheapest land, which is about 2.5 to 3 lakhs an acre. You have no roads, no network, no water availability, no manpower available. So as an industry, we should also look into that, rather than hiring manpower from tier 1, tier 2, whether should not we go and develop this manpower at ITI diplomas, which are closer to the site, district level. Those guys will work in that moment. See, frankly, if I tell you my experience, when I'm sending one of my team member to, say, go to this project site, Monday will go, Friday will sell me, so I want to come back. So is your project over in 5 days? You are used to working 5 days working style. Project doesn't work like this. So as an industry, we have to see that on the other side, where we are going to put up this huge capacity in solar parks, in greenfield projects, we have to develop the capacity there. So these are a few points which I want to put up.
Great. No, I know that's a very interesting point that you just, you know, kind of bring out. I think we are almost out of time. Maybe what I just require now, just one word answer for all of you. So you know that the government has set up a target of 100 gigawatts by 2022. That's 60 in utility, 40 on the rooftop of the distributed. In one word, I wouldn't want your predictions on how much out of 60 we're going to achieve and how much out of 40 are we going to achieve. Pratyush, you would like to go first?
Achieve by when? Okay, that's important. I don't think we'll achieve it. How much? Anyone's guess. On the rooftop, of course, not even 25%. On utility, maybe 50 to 70%. That's my guess.
Yeah, I think on the utility scale projects, probably our achievement will be 60-70% probably. That's with the present we are going, I think, and with the low prices, I think there will be a market for this. But on the rooftop, I it is anybody's guess. It's difficult for me to say.
So 2022, no? So you're not going to ask me this question again for next 5 years?
No. Till the time the government target remained unchanged, yes, and we reach 2022, I'm going to ask you, yes, this question every year.
I would be held accountable for next 5 years. Okay. So I think 45 and 10. 45 on utility scale and maybe 10,000
we might. So when you say 45 on utility scale, if I'm not wrong, what we are sitting already at 12 gigawatts installed in utility scale, right? We have another around 15 gigawatts which has already been tendered and under construction into various phases.
Yeah,
so 15 plus 12 would make 27. So essentially, what you're saying is 13 gigawatts kind of more, you know, kind of coming in.
See, what I am trying to judge is that maybe we have 5 years left. 12,000 minus 45, so we are talking about 6,000-7,000 megawatts per annum. You will see bumps also in between.
So,
there would be periods where for a year or two nothing would happen, and maybe 10 megawatts in rooftop. A lot of the people from grid connected side will now move to rooftop after this all lower tariff regime.
Correct.
But it is, at the end of the day, it is crystal gazing.
Correct.
Frankly, I don't know. I'll go with Yes Bank's projection on this.
I'll get my views on this. You know, at the very end.
So I think this is interesting that we are thinking only from our sides, but we have to think from the person's side who has announced this. And our Prime Minister is known for achieving his commitments. So I would always believe him. I personally feel that we will exceed the utility scale target by at least 15-20 gigawatts. But rooftop is going to be a challenge. So my take would be that out of 100 gigawatt, we may reach around 85 to 90 gigawatts, out of which some 70-75 would be utility and balance would be rooftop. But take my words, he is not going to miss it out.
So I'll go with Vikas' view. I believe Mr. Modi has set the target right, balanced with the other forms of the generation. Yes, there are hurdles. I believe if we go on changing only few segment like SECI tender, NTPC, and few other state tenders, you're not going to reach there. For reaching there, you need to enable and, of course, streamline the regulatory policy in the state. As on date, different states have different regulatory policies. You need to bring them on same pace. Open out open access easily. Put in place all the net metering policies in all the states. Smoothen the process so that rooftop will also become popular and there are less hurdles in the way. So we are going to reach there. We need to take few more aggressive steps.
Great. You asked for the Yes Bank view. So I'll not give a Yes Bank view. I'll give the Danish view to you. I believe my view is it's around 50 gigawatts for the utility scale, around 20 gigawatts for the rooftop. And I believe now we have reached an inflection point where our challenges are not on the supply side. And so at less than 3 rupees, supply side is kind of settled. I think so now our challenges are on the demand side. I think so electric vehicles, push towards electric vehicles is going to be the one single biggest factor. Even if we can transfer
10% of the transportation demand, you know, this question about power surplus, where will my thermal capacity go, you know, the 10 nuclear power plants capacity, how will that go? I think all of those questions will sort it for themselves. I think it's on a demand side. We also now believe there is a view to now change our entire regulatory and tariff philosophies. Today, if I as a customer consume for first 400 units is at 4 rupees, then etc. I think now that if genuinely you are in a power surplus scenario, I am a paying customer. In fact, the utility should come and say, now my tariff is for residential and let's say the metro cities. Beyond 800 units, you get a discount. You need to incentivize consumption that will also propel electric vehicles, etc. There is no reason why a person who's consuming more should now pay more for power. Those are all historical tariff philosophies which belong to the earlier age, you know, where we were dealing with massive shortages. You need to give very clear demand signals to the market. And yes, if we have to move, you know, I think Anand was mentioning, we need to have a 100 gigawatt target for saying all renewables.
I think if you look at our per capita consumption, it is 1/4 the BRIC nation, leave aside the developed nation, right? So there is a huge capacity, but yes, industry, customers, commercials, they all need to be given power at an affordable rate, so that first of all the diesel genset which run in the country need to be shut off. So I think the achievement of 2022 from here on will not be how many tenders the government brought in. It will not be a supply side phenomenon. It will be a demand side phenomenon. Anyway, thanks so much all of you for joining us. For joining me. Thanks. You have been a great panel. And Anand, do we have time for a couple of questions?
Yeah,
maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe you can take two questions. Maybe you can identify yourself. The question. Keep it short. Please keep it as a question. And also, if there is a particular panelist that you are addressing the question to. Yes. Yes, please.
To identify the risks and chalk out mitigation measures. Is it done in case of solar projects?
Absolutely.
Yes, I mean, to answer you, yes, it is done.
It is done.
Yeah.
Okay. So we highlight the unforeseen risks also. Normally, which
that's what exactly we have done. I think in the last round, right? Maybe. Pradeep can take it. Yeah.
Don't confuse the short gestation period of a solar project into believing that the developers are not doing their project planning and all the risk analysis. It's just that in a thermal project, we used to take 4 years to do it. Here we do it in 12 months.
Just a question from a person who's not involved in solar right now. That's all. Thanks.
So I'll take that question. We, as a solar developer, whenever we envisage any project, and be it any space, be it tender, be it an open access or any the rooftop business model, we identify the various risks associated with the project, and we do plan for all the mitigation strategies. And definitely, with those mitigation strategy, we go to the lender. Lender definitely goes into the details of what are the risks and how the developer is going to take care of the to those risks. If the lender is not satisfied, they're not going to finance, definitely.
Absolutely. Any other questions? Yes, sir. So,
saying that developer has to reckon with the risks that are coming because of imposition of certain taxes and duty. And my point is, I have gone through a lot of tariff hearings. Unless you formally submit to the regulator, you're not going to get any answer. We can debate here for years. The moment you submit competitive bid one project to the regulator, he will open your numbers. He will start probing as to what is your return on equity. Now, that's a very dangerous territory. You should not go. So what is left to us? What is left to us is use the section 61 BCD, where reasonability of return is protected for a generating company, which I think solar is just, and also I think 181, where, and some other sections, where under Electricity Act, government can give policy directives to both CERC and state can give to the regulatory commission. If they don't give this policy directive, I think we are in big trouble. Just my comment.
Absolutely. I think these comments come from Mr. Rajendra. Sir. He heads AES in India, which is the largest global utility. So he comes from experience. I think so. We agree to you completely, sir. When you are a competitive bidding process, opening up the bid is the last thing you should do. Tomorrow, all the projects which were awarded around 24 months, 18 months back, none of the developers even anticipated that, the module, I think the most aggressive numbers we heard was people were working with around 40, 42 cents. While by the time they actually procured the modules, it was around 35, 33 cents. If, what happens if the regulator starts opening and listen, you guys made super normal profit on these projects. I think it's a path less treaded to. I think the Mundra and the Adani, compensatory tariff hearings have proved that. When you are going into a competitive bidding,
take all these risks and ideally don't open the financial model in front of the regulator and the policymaker. And we agree with that. Maybe last question. Yes, sir.
Question is, I'm basically, I take care of recruitment for solar companies. So are there people to achieve the targets? Okay, you talk about money, technology and everything. But my pertinent question is, are there really people on the technical front, on the project management front? You all talk about business development. Most of the recruitment that happens in this thing is most on the business development. We want to achieve something, whether on the rooftop or on the grid mounted. But my only pertinent question is, I go with you. I go with your optimism and I go with Modi and all that is fine. But are the government and are the developers and the EPC people are really taking effort in scaling up the manpower requirement that is to achieve your targets? Thank you.
So one important thing about India is, which we must remember, is that our biggest strength is our human capital, right? IT industry grew because mechanical engineers also started working on computers. So basically, if you have projects, then you are having good qualified manpower available. And I will also give you another number where it says that outside America and China, Indian EPC companies are the largest and the best EPC companies in the world. They are working not only in India, but outside India also, many, many countries, the Sterling Wilson guys, these guys also, several good companies, L&T, they are all sitting with huge manpower and technical strengths. So it is just when you need them, they will get deployed. So I don't think that is going to be an issue at all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think indeed Danish moderated the panel very well, and good thing about these panel discussions is a lot of things can be pulled up, and the audience were super amazing. So big clap for the audience and definitely the speakers. I request now Danish ji to present the memento of appreciation to all the panelists, please.